Hey everybody, and welcome to another episode of the Disney Resorts Podcast. My name is Kenny Hayes, and I am joined alongside, as always, by the one, the only, Walt Ramirez.
Good evening, Ken. How are you?
I'm very happy, Walter. You know what today is, right?
What's today? It's Super Bowl Sunday
when we air.
What is the over-under?
I don't know. But I'm going to put the hat on for a second.
Okay. Let's hope
don't
that
embarrass
this doesn't...
Me. Don't let's embarrass
hope it
doesn't, me.
I hope it's good luck for you.
Well, the last two Super Bowls have not been good luck for me. So now I'm taking it off.
Oh, man. You should just leave it on the whole time. So it's good to be back. Yeah. Good to see that our technical issues have been resolved, at least temporarily anyway. Yes. Let's hope.
So the funny thing is that Walter and I have been talking, and you may have noticed over the last two episodes, since the holidays, we've been having a lot of issues with the internet in our area. We actually were taping several days before Super Bowl Sunday. We tried to tape earlier in this week, and for 2 hours, yes, 2 hours, that's how dedicated we are. We could see each other, and he could not hear me. Drove us nuts. So finally, I asked my wife to call the cable company, and lo and behold, there was something wrong with the good old internet. So it looks like after doing tests, the Wi-Fi is now fixed.
Yep, the gremlins are out of there, I guess.
The gremlins are out of there. So, everybody, we're glad to be back. We apologize for missing that last episode. We have a good show lined up. Also, when this airs, Walter and I will also, not only will it be Super Bowl Sunday, go Niners, we will also be in Walt Disney World. So,
yes.
So, we're very happy with that. Probably throughout the show, we'll talk a little bit about it. We have a lot lined up that most of all, Walter and I, it's been very stressful at work. So we're just looking forward to just going to blow off some steam, but we will have a lot to talk about when we return. Just a little slight change in our show. Normally, if you've been listening and watching, we go into the news first, then we usually have a discussion at the end about a particular topic. We wanted to change it up a little bit. We want to get the discussion and the flow going better. And what we've talked about is that our discussions, we think, are very good, and it leads into a lot of in-depth discussion. So while we're still going to cover the news, we're going to do it in a little different way. We're going to keep asking each other questions back and forth. We have a bunch to go over, so just a little slight change, nothing big. Everybody relax. But with that being said, Walter, I'm going to turn it over to you. What do you first got for us? What's the first one?
Well, you got an interesting piece of mail in the other day that you mentioned to me.
Yes, I did.
From your DVC fans over there in Walt Disney World. Apparently, they are trying to sell you some cabins.
They are.
And it was, in fact, so sad because I noticed when you sent me the picture, they couldn't even put your name on the envelope. They just called you member, which is pretty sad because I'm pretty sure when you get your invoice for your taxes and dues, it doesn't say member on there, does it?
No, it does not say DVC member in my address. It says Kenny Hayes, you owe us money.
Yeah, so
but that was a good catch by you.
Yeah, I just thought, I was like, wait a minute. Like, they can't even put his name on the envelope. How sad is that?
You know,
but so what was your take on it? I mean, do you obviously we've talked a lot about the cabins at Fort Wilderness, and now you finally have some material in front of you where you can actually talk about numbers and points and years.
I think you and I, and correct me if I'm wrong, Walt, like you said, we've spoken in depth about this already numerous times, but now there's a lot more information since our last show during the holidays. I kind of like the inside. I do like it. The outside is warming up on me, but I still don't think it's related to Wilderness. Like you said, it looks more like a cargo container on steroids. But it's something I think I would definitely try. But I don't think, unless something, unless I get hit in the head with a rock. I don't think I'm ever going to purchase there. No, because there's a few other places that I would purchase if I was ever to add on again. But I would never purchase there. And number one, and we're going to get into that momentarily, is, you know, looking at the price per point, and not even that so much, is that the price per point for your dues, which is considerably high.
Yeah, that's sky high, isn't it? Isn't it close to what Hilton Head is?
And it's even more. So your Vero Beach and your Hilton Head, or if not the highest, they're one of the highest.
Mm-hmm.
I believe Vero right now is over $10 a point. I could be wrong. I'm not one of those DVC. Forgive me, DVC nerds. I don't know the prices per point per, you know, down to like some others. But right now, let's do it. Price per point is going to be $225 a point. The annual dues per point are going to be $12.16. It's high.
Yeah, that's very high.
That's high. You know, it's now, the good thing is now they have some add-on incentives. Like now, if you are a DVC member, if you are a current DVC member, now through April 1st, you could get anywhere from $2 off to $16 off per point, depending on how many points you want to get from there. Do you want to add on?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, I slightly, when you opened, you mentioned about you're kind of warming up to it. I mean, I have no skin in the game, so I don't really, you know, but just my opinion of looking at it, I'm not a, you know, to me, the decor is okay. I don't, like you said, I don't believe that it is wilderness related or themed that much.
Yeah. Yep.
But for that point structure, to not have an amenity such as a washer and dryer in there, where pretty much I think, I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, but is there any other DVC two bedroom or one, I think one bedrooms have washers and dryers, I believe.
Yep. Yeah, right? One bedroom, so, and up all have washers and dryers.
So is there anywhere else on property that's DVC that doesn't have a washer and dryer? Are they the only ones?
To my knowledge, they're the only ones.
Wow. So you're paying the highest point structure in taxes and dues, and you don't have a washer and dryer, and you're supposed to be in a cabin. So theoretically, you're not going to have any. It's not like you could go to the pool to do your laundry the way you would at some of the other resorts.
Well, I think the thought is, you know, since you are staying in a cabin, you're supposed to walk down to the river. You're supposed to drop your clothes in. Oh, no, I forgot. Never mind. I thought I saw this in the flyer. I thought I saw it in the flyer. You want the real cabin experience?
Where's that river located?
Yeah. So you go down to the ranch, you get your horse, you take your horse down to the river, tie it off to the tree, and then go down and wash your clothes. No, but all kidding aside, I think you're right that, you know, excluding the studios, that this would be the only other than, you know, your one bedroom, two bedroom, three bedroom Granvilles all have washer and dryer. This does not. You know, you're also sharing that master bedroom because it has the bunk beds in it. So if you're looking for privacy, you're not going to get that here either, unless you're staying with a party of four, because then you could put them out in the living room. I don't know. Like I said, I don't want to bash it because I do like the way it looks. I just think they're missing the mark with certain things, especially when it comes to, like I said in a previous episode, is it a deal breaker that it doesn't have a washer and dryer? No, because I've stayed in studios and will stay in a studio again without it. But I will tell you, I do miss it. I do miss doing the laundry the night before and packing up to come home, and everything is fresh. I just take it out and put it back in the drawers and you're good to go. Or like right now on our trip, we're going to have it and I don't have to bring that many clothes down because I could do a load. I could do a load and I'm good to go. I like the way the inside looks, but like what Walter said, it doesn't look like a cabin. It doesn't look like a cabin. The cabins that are there currently look like a cabin inside because they are a cabin. And I think is that they're what they're trying to do is say, hey, come stay at a cabin, you know, that's all dolled up. Because I think, correct me if I'm wrong, Walt, but this is what I thought about it. I don't think they could have put it up for sale with the cabins they currently have. Do you agree? I mean, I've never stayed in it. I'm just going off of appearance. I don't think it would have sold. So they had to bougie it up in order to get people. Yeah, I'm in the woods. So you're getting an experience of I'm in a cabin, you know, but it's not a cabin.
Yeah, no, I know what you're saying as far as, you know, making it, snazzing it up a little bit, but I just don't. I just think that they just, I don't think they put a lot of thought into it, to be honest with you. I mean, that's at least my opinion on it. It doesn't look like I agree that the old cabins didn't, you know, weren't going to sell from a DVC standpoint, but then give me a product that would knock my socks off and say, you know, despite all of the, you know, the hurdles that they put in front of you with the taxes and dues and the highest, and the price point's not exactly low either.
No.
If you're going to do that, then say, okay, but look at the product we're giving you. The product we're giving you is a superior product.
Yes.
I don't think it's a superior product. I mean, do you agree with that? Or
I agree with that. Like I said, it's probably the wrong word to use. It's like now it's a true make-believe cabin.
Yeah. Yeah.
But, you know, also some of the other things that has come out since our last show, February 1st, sales have now opened for current DVC members. February 27th, it will open to the public. So anyone who is not a DVC member can then purchase. Booking dates. February 15th, DVC members who have added on at the cabins can start making reservations. March 12th, new DVC members whose home resort is the cabins can start booking. And April 23rd, all DVC members can start booking stays at the new cabins. So,
okay.
And the
was there anything in that
July
information
1st.
That you look at and say, okay, this is, it's interesting. It makes me at least, I know you said you probably wouldn't buy there, but anything that if you didn't have multiple contracts, would you look at it and go, okay, is there anything at all that you would consider, or
no.
it's just not your cup of tea?
No, not my cup of tea at all.
No. Okay. Nope.
I would consider Wilderness Lodge. You know, staying on the Copper Creek side, I would look
right
at that. No.
Okay, so let's make a bold prediction right now. Okay, you can write it down. Today is February the 9th. We're taping. We're going to make this prediction. Fort Wilderness Cabins will not sell out. Are you willing to make that prediction
within the next year?
We'll put it on the same list as Alani and Riviera. Or is it just because there's not enough of, there's so few of them that they probably will sell out?
I think there's more of a chance they do sell out just because of the inventory.
Okay.
But it would, I'm going to say we're going to be sitting here a year from now and it's still going to be open. So,
I agree.
And I don't think they're going to do well. I could be wrong. I don't think they're going to do well.
Now, we've been right on a lot of things if you go back and watch some of our previous shows. So
so I hope I'm wrong.
You know,
I hope I'm wrong.
Yeah.
But we're going to say.
So I wanted to ask you about our other favorite topic and prediction that we went back a few shows ago, or actually almost a year ago. Fox Orlando reported that the Galactic Starcruiser they filed for, I believe it was a permit to put up an awning. And so when I went and dug a little deeper at the company who was issued the permit, it's Sun State Awning and Graphics Design. So they're not a, they're not a company that particularly does massive renovations.
Okay.
Seems like they only do, you know, certain alterations, which made me kind of scratch my head and wonder, what are they putting there?
Yeah,
do you
weird.
Think that the Galactic Starcruiser eventually will be a themed hotel at some point?
I do. I do think it will reopen as a hotel. You would think that the proximity to Hollywood Studios and Galaxy's Edge, that mm-hmm. it would stay Star Wars themed. I think so, because then you're going to have to spend a boatload of money on something that you have already lost a boatload of money on mm-hmm. to completely retheme. And now, everyone, that doesn't mean they won't. Because if right. Disney thinks they have, I just personally think, due to its proximity, due to what you currently have there and the technology that you use there, that I could see them, you and I have talked about it, and we said this a year ago, is that why not just make it a regular Star Wars hotel? A themed yeah. hotel. You can upcharge that and still not price people out like you did yeah. for the Star Cruiser. That's my thing. What's your thoughts on it?
You know, I have a slightly different take on it. Instead of a hotel, because I just can't see them doing a hotel in that location mm-hmm. Because of the proximity to the park.
Yeah.
I think they might go with a restaurant, a Star Wars-themed restaurant, something similar to Space 220, I believe, in Epcot.
Yes. Yep.
Something like that, where you theme it to a Star Wars theme. Everyone, all of the servers in the restaurant are all in Star Wars garb and in character, perhaps.
Yeah.
And the menus kind of catered towards that theming. And I actually think that there's a possibility. I don't know the actual physical distance between the park and where that Galactic Star Cruiser hotel was located. I don't think it's very far, because they used to have that box
yeah,
truck that
far.
Would take you over.
Yep.
But do you think there's a possibility that D23 that they will announce an expansion of the Star Wars of Galaxy's Edge and expand that restaurant into that whole area, make it a little bit bigger?
That would not be a bad idea. That's actually not a bad idea at all, because some of the hit back has been since it's opened is, while Galaxy's Edge was so well done, themed, immersive, it just wasn't big enough. There's not a lot mm-hmm. to do there. You know, you have two rides, Olga's Canteen, and then you're out.
Yeah.
That's all you got. So would it make sense to? I think so. I will say I do like your idea. So let me float this one back at you. My mm-hmm. only, while I like the idea of the restaurant, what would you do with the, I believe it was 100 rooms that they had. What would you do with them? Would you make it like a big, what about this? I'll let you answer the question first, and then I have a thought. So what would you do with those rooms then? Would you just kind of dissolve them and make it maybe storage, or make it just a very large restaurant?
Yeah, I mean, you could make it into like a large restaurant, because then you would have a much larger area that you would basically be wasted space. You could, thinking way, way out of the box, but you could turn it into like a gigantic, like shopping mall area in outer space, you know, like a Star Wars themed, you know, merchandise, you know, area.
I like it.
But it could, you know, it could very well be where they just phase those out, you know, that's possible too. What was your take on it?
What I thought about is, can you have a very immersive restaurant like you have, but mm-hmm. also still keep a small, still have the hotel side of it, you know, have the hotel and restaurant, and you pay a premium? Because I do like the idea of Walter and I were never able to experience it, but you know, him and I did watch numerous videos over the year and a half that it was open, and it was very immersive. Like we never knocked it for like what it was. We knocked it for
the price.
You're going to pay the price point. You're paying beyond the premium. Mm-hmm. And you're what I used to say. I say it was a 36-hour torture chamber.
Torture chamber, yeah. You
know, yeah. We're like, but like when you were done with it, if you wanted to do it again, it was the same thing again. So how many right. times can you keep going to the well at $2,000, $3,000, $6,000 for a 36-hour excursion? You know, I'm no high-end executive. I don't pretend to be, nor I ever will be. But just the common sense, like you and I would talk about it all the time, how can it sustain?
Right.
And it didn't. And it didn't.
It didn't. Yeah, it couldn't. Here's the thing, though, Ken. I think that the problem with having the rooms and having a hotel there is that you're going to run into the same issue that you had before. Disney is not capable of pricing anything within a realistic standpoint.
Yeah.
So like, as you see now with your DVC cabins, sky high, right? Everything is sky yep. high. So you don't, do you honestly think that if they did convert that to themed hotel rooms, I mean, you're looking at probably $1,100 a night minimum.
Yeah.
So again, here you go. You're going down the same road where you're going to overprice the rooms, and you're going to have a small niche of people that will be interested.
Yeah.
But it's just not going to be sustainable for the long term. Like you and I might go there and say, okay, let's check this place out. Let's, you know, you do it once and it's a one-off. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Which has always been my theory with, like, for example, with my argument with Oga's Cantina, it's a one-off. You go there, you have, you check out the atmosphere, you check out the bar, and then that's it, because the prices of the drinks are ridiculously high. So again, I just think that with the rooms being converted, there is no way they're going to give you, you know, even a $500 a night room there. It's not going to happen, because think about it. The proximity to the park, you would literally be walking out of your hotel room and going into Hollywood Studios. So that right there in itself is a premium that they would upcharge you for. So it kind of reminds me of the hotel in Disneyland, the Grand Californian. So you're literally, you walk out and you're right into Disneyland,
which is
the same thing. It just would be themed, you know, with a Star Wars theme. I mean they're kind of in a corner with this place, because it is, like you said, there's a lot of space there. But I think that in my opinion, I think the best thing to do there would be to just expand that into that area and try to expand. Because I think, as we've talked about in previous episodes, D23 this year has to be beyond a home run.
Yes.
It has to be like a multiple grand slams on this thing. They have to come in and they have to just literally like knock your socks off. And this would be one of those things. Okay. This would be, it would be a small part, but it would be one of those things where they could say, hey, we're going to expand Galaxy's Edge and we're going to include the Galactic Starcruiser in it with, you know, a restaurant or more shopping or whatever. Because the most popular things right now in Galaxy's Edge are the merchandise.
Yeah.
So the lightsaber is super popular. The droids are super popular. Build your own droid. So the merch is popular. They just don't have enough of it, like you mm-hmm. pointed out. It's just such a, you know, it kind of reminds me of Harry Potter over in Universal. You walk through and you're like, wow, that's all there is. So now they've obviously expanded that a little bit more from its initial opening, but. You know, we'll see. It's like you pointed out, we got to keep our fingers crossed. So we'll see how that goes.
You know, well, I think we talked about real quick before we end this segment.
Yeah.
I think they had to wait for, they couldn't do anything for, what was it, a year because of tax purposes, I think.
Yeah, there was, I forget what
there was some kind of clause with that. Yep.
There was a time frame on it. Yeah.
Yep. Okay.
So your other favorite place, still under construction behind walls, Cake Bake Shop over at the Boardwalk.
Cake Bake, where are you?
Now, we were supposed to have pastries and cakes in 2024. Still not open.
No.
So we were hoping to go there on this trip and try out some of those wonderful pastries. But it's, yeah. Nope. Now, your other favorite place there, or your daughter's favorite place,
Big River.
Oh, help me out.
Big River.
Big River. Yeah, Big River Country. Now, they closed, sadly.
Yes, they did. Yep.
That was one of Meadow's favorite watering holes there.
Yeah.
But what is your thoughts on that piece of property? I mean, what do you think? Because now, keep in mind, we've seen how long it's taken for the ESPN zone to be converted. It's still under construction.
Yeah.
I think it might be the same construction crew that was working on Epcot. I think they have the same work pattern. You know, let's
they also and the other half of the crew came from Tron. I was as shocked about Big River, Walt. I'm shocked.
Yeah. I mean, it's surprising. We saw news that it was closed. They were having some financial difficulties in other areas of the country where they have, restaurants. But, moving forward from that, like, because we've talked about this briefly before we came on the air, and I'll let you throw that one out there that, we have some thoughts on it, but go ahead and tell me what you're thinking.
So just real quick, anyone who didn't know, if you're living under a rock, as of January 21st, the Big River Bar and Grill located on Disney's Boardwalk did close permanently. So right now, if you were a Big River fan, like my daughter and her boyfriend, you're out. Got to find a new watering hole. So what's funny is Disney is now temporarily replacing the food option by rotating a food truck daily in the area of, which I made a comment over on one of the Facebook pages that I belong to in the DVC world. And I says, nothing says deluxe like food trucks. And then people started coming after me. It got hot. I could defend myself. And at the top, it was just a joke. Right? Okay. I like food trucks. But I guess you could say it is a good temporary fix, because at least you're providing some kind of food option. My concern now is that, A, how long is Big River going to be empty? And question number two, B, what will it be? What is Disney going to do with it when it reopens? And I think that's the biggest question. You agree, Walt?
Yeah, I do. We talked about something that would fit within that Boardwalk theme. And I think we both agreed that a typical Boardwalk pizza parlor would be an awesome, addition. Now, people are going to say, well, there's a pizza, window there already at the Boardwalk. Yes, we realize that, but we're talking about a typical, like, New Jersey, Northeast, New York area pizza parlor where you have, like, as you pointed out, you have a guy standing there twirling the dough and making the pizza, and you're putting on a show in a way, which would fit with the theming of the Boardwalk, because the Boardwalk does have a lot of entertainment and shows, especially in the evening hours. And to have an eatery, a typical Boardwalk pizza parlor, and one of Kenny and I's favorite desserts, the Zeppelis, I believe that's how you pronounce it.
Yes, correct.
I always screw that up. But something like that, where you could even add that to the establishment, and have them making both. And that would fit perfectly into, the Boardwalk theme. Would it kind of compete a little bit with the Cake Bake Shop? I mean, possibly, but, I don't think so. I mean, what do you think about opening up a place like that, like a pizza parlor?
I love the idea when we talked about it pre-show. Like, Walter and I had a discussion, and I don't want to get off topic for a second, but I agree. I think it's, you know, it's modeled after turn of the century Atlantic City Boardwalk. While they, I don't think they were necessarily twirling pizzas and dressed in white with the guy with flowers over them, I wasn't there. But if you want, you want like a Jersey Boardwalk now, that's what you're going to see. You know, the guy's right up in the window. You walk up, it's kind of open. You could sit down outside or you can go in, get pizza, sandwiches, stuff like that. I think that would be a great fit. And what we also talked about prior to recording was Boardwalk, just like Old Key West, their biggest hangups are they don't have a counter service. You know, like Saratoga's got Artist Palette. Right? May not be big, but it's a place I can go and get breakfast, lunch, and dinner.
Yep.
This place, you could turn it into a quick service, even like a pizzeria or just a regular quick service. You know, like, yeah. I talked to Walter and I said, I've only been in Big River once. And it's got, it's like oblonged inside. Like, it has a weird dimension, but utilize it to your benefit. Like, put a quick service in here. It's perfect for it. You already have signature dining with Flying Fish. You're already going to have some kind of signature dining with Cake Bake. And you already have, oh, and I like the restaurant too. Why can't I think of the Italian restaurant's name? Oh,
Trattoria Al Forno.
Yes, there we go. So, you know, you can lower the standard a little bit where it doesn't have to be fancy. You know, and you're already on the other side of the boardwalk that you already have jelly rolls and the dance club. So it could be a little more themed on that end of the boardwalk. And then on the other side of the boardwalk, you get a lot of more upper class, a little pinkies, you know, pinkies up. I think it's a good idea. My biggest concern is how long it'll wait. So,
yeah, you know, typically it's going to probably take a few months, if not longer, maybe into the fall. It depends on whether or not they have someone lined up already for the location. But again, I think that they should put some thought into it more than just throwing a tenant in there and throwing any typical eatery. I like your idea. I like your idea of a food court or of a quick service type of an establishment. You could even cater that towards like a boardwalk theme, like a typical New Jersey theme where you have multiple you know, areas of different types of food, like sub sandwiches, pizza, mm-hmm. you know, that sort of thing. So you have something themed in that towards the boardwalk, but at the same time you're providing a quick service location for a place that's really underserved. So, you know,
so let me ask you this, Walt, before we move to our next topic, we also brought up prior to recording, did he also maybe keep the microbrewery theme since it's already set up for that and maybe go out to one of the locals in Orlando, a microbrewery, and try and bring them in? Possibility.
Yeah. I mean, that wouldn't be a bad idea, but if you notice, they're really almost like, and I'm not saying that they did this intentionally, but I think that they're almost getting away from like that bar atmosphere there. Because think about it, you had the ESPN zone, that's gone. That was a bar atmosphere. God. You have the why do I keep forgetting the name of the restaurant?
Trattoria Al Forno?
No, the one that did just close that we're talking about.
Big River.
Big River, I'm sorry. So yeah, so Big River, I mean, they that went away. So it's almost like they're getting rid of places where people are going to come and hang out and, you know, try different beer. I would be really surprised if they brought in a microbrewery. I would welcome it, but it would shock me because it seems like they're getting away from that. And like you pointed out, they're going more towards a Victorian, like boardwalk, more old fashioned type of like an older clientele type of a theming. Yes. Almost. And I'm not saying they're doing it intentionally, but it certainly looks like it's going in that direction. So,
Yes, and I will finish up with this on this segment because you and I talked about this as well. And I'm going to leave this for a show when we come back from vacation, is that look what they're doing inside the boardwalk, whether you're on the villa side refurbishment or the inside. It's going Victorian,
mm-hmm.
which ties into the cake bake shop. So I think they're going for that more turn of the century boardwalk look than they are of like present day boardwalk look. But
right.
I have some thoughts about that, but that'll take up 20 minutes. But I'm excited, but I love
it. It sounds interesting. Yeah. I'm open to that. Go ahead. This is a conversation. Okay. Go ahead. I want to.
So people have like really lost their minds about the current refurbishment. And they're saying how like they're losing their theme, they're losing their theme, they're losing their theme. So somebody on one of the Facebook pages put a pictures. It's four different pictures of a room from Boardwalk from, what was it, Walt, like the last like 15 years. So it was, you know, like 15 years ago. Then it was under the soft goods refurbishment and now to present day. I'm trying to sit there as a fan of the Boardwalk. I'm a fan of the Boardwalk. I don't necessarily agree with what everyone's talking about. You could sit there and tell me you don't like the theme. Understand 100%. It's in the eyes of the beholder, right? You either like it or you don't. What I'm having trouble wrapping my head around with this particular resort and with the rooms is, oh, they're losing the theme. They're worried about the color. So many people are freaking out about that aqua color because they went yellow now. I look at, you have a beautiful headboard now that's plaid. You had this white little wooden strips on the wall before that. So what I'm trying to get at is that I'm looking back in past pictures and I'm looking up current, and you didn't lose some major theming. It wasn't right. Overly themed to begin with. And now people are losing their minds because they have pictures of Mickey, Minnie, Goofy, and that on the wall that are in the Victorian era. And they have a couple pictures up. While I think they could have added more, I don't think it looks terrible at all. I really don't. And when I sat there, because I think I felt a little differently when it first happened, because we did discuss the Boardwalk refurbishment. But then when I go back and I see pictures from the past, like I'm trying to grapple with, what are you people talking about? You know, I just don't see it.
You always have that small segment.
This is just my opinion.
Yeah, you always have that small segment of people that are very passionate about any kind of change, whether yeah. it's a decor change or some sort of structural or change to any type of you know, facility or construction.
What I was just trying to get at it is looking at pictures over the last like 15 years of how the Boardwalk Resort rooms looked, right? Up to now, the refurbishment, I'm like, you would have thought like it was a carnival inside people's rooms, the way they were talking, like they're destroying it, they're changing. I'm like, no, they just changed certain things. And it's okay not to like it. That's not what I'm saying. You could not like the decor, the color. I get it. However, I don't see what all the fuss is about when it comes to they're killing the theming, because maybe I'm missing something. I don't know. And I'm coming from a person who's a Boardwalk fan. So I think it's just people don't like or are not used to this new change. So they're losing their minds. Because I love Saratoga's refurb, but is it overly Disney themed? No, it's not. But it's also supposed to resemble the real Saratoga Springs with a flair of Disney. Which I think they do, and I think they accomplish it. So I think they accomplish it very well. But I don't want throw up either. So, and I know it's tough, and sometimes they miss it where they walk that line of it's good, but you don't want to cross that line and be like, oh man, it's like a child's room in here. You know what I mean? So sorry about that, Walt. What I was saying was, is that I think it has to do with a lot of people who have stayed at the Boardwalk, owned at the Boardwalk for a long time.
Right.
That have seen the changes and have liked the past and what they've gotten from it. And they don't like the changes now and are letting it be known. I think if you were to take newer Disney fans and put them in this refurbishment, I think they would think it was beautiful and they would have an excellent stay.
Yeah.
And like I said, it's okay. I'm not ripping anybody. I'm just trying to grasp, put my head around it and go, okay, I understand it. I just think it's a lot to do with people hanging on to the past and they don't want to change it. That's just my opinion.
Yeah, no, I kind of agree with you on that. I think a lot of the people are overreacting to a lot of those changes. So you and I are going to be heading down. By the time this airs, we will actually be physically in, hopefully, we'll be physically in Walt Disney World. And we are going to be staying at the Treehouse Villas. So we're going to definitely discuss that on a future show. Kenan is trying to get me over to Festival of the Arts for the first time. So we're going to try to walk around and consume some of those wonderful foods. And I've seen some very interesting food kiosks that I'm looking forward to trying. One is over at the Craftsman's Courtyard, a grilled pork belly and salsa verde on grilled sourdough.
That
looks pretty good.
That sounds delicious.
There's also at that same Craftsman's Courtyard, there's a skirt steak with caramelized onions and mushrooms. So that sounds pretty good too. Yeah. I'm starting to get hungry.
Two for two.
At Cuisine Classique, there's a beef Wellington. And I know this isn't in your realm, but I'm going to try the mussels there. So that looks interesting.
Four out of five, Walt. I'm still liking my odds.
Yeah, yeah. And at the refreshment port, which I think you remember where that's located. That's over by when you kind of take that turn when you're heading towards Canada. The refreshment port there has a gnocchi poutine with wine braised beef and cheese curds. So I don't know if you've ever had poutine, but it's basically like a French Canadian version of French fries. Of course, all our Canadian friends are going to be hating on me for saying that now. But
don't hate us.
I love maple syrup. There is and I also thought of Meadow. So we have the Gourmet Landscapes, which has a verjuice roasted beets with goat cheese salad. So that's something that she might be interested in trying. I know you won't be lining up for that.
I don't look like this eating stuff like that.
Well, here, I'm going to make up for it with the next one. So at Vibrant and Vivido, there is a chorizo and potato empanada. So you, I think you would enjoy the empanadas.
That sounds good.
And then for dessert, over at the American Adventure, there's a hummingbird cake with banana pecan cake dipped in cream cheese icing with caramel sauce.
Cream cheese.
Caramel sauce and warm pineapple compote. So maybe you may not want the warm pineapple compote, but I think everything else looks pretty good.
Yeah, that sounds good. Yeah, anything with cheesecake on it, sign me up. I'll dig that.
So those are. Let's see. That's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. There's six places there that I think we should be able to probably knock all six off and give you mini reviews.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Hopefully our Wi-Fi won't be acting up and we can maybe even do a live stream. We'll see.
Yeah.
You know,
we got a big deck we could do it from too.
Yeah. So we'll give that a shot. But looking forward to the trip and looking forward to my first time at Festival of the Arts. Now, speaking of festivals, we're gonna wrap this up now with Flower and Garden Festival starts immediately after Festival of the Arts ends.
Yep.
I think within about a week's time in between.
Yeah, it starts February 28th.
Okay.
And this ends February 19th. So, yeah. Yep, just about a little more than a week.
A little more than a week. Yep. So one of the things that Ken and I noticed is they've really truncated the Flower and Garden Festival this year. Yeah. Usually they would extend it well into the summer months, into the July months.
Yeah.
And I have a thought on that, but what is your reasoning, you think, regarding the shortening of the Flower and Garden Festival?
Well, I think if you look back, because what I did leading up to the show, I looked at, of course, 2023's, which is significantly, it's actually 36 days shorter than 2023's. I'm sorry. 2024's festival is 36 days shorter than 2023. So I went back because I remember the first year we started going was in 2014. And I went back in 2014. It started at basically the same time back March 5th, but it ended on May 18th. 2015 started May 4th. I'm sorry, May. March 4th ended May 17th. And then you got into 2019 pre-COVID. March 6th started, ended, and it extended out to June 3rd. Remember, everyone was starting to complain, wow, they're extending these festivals. They're extending the festivals. They're extending the festivals. And then, of course, throw COVID right out, 2020, throw COVID out the window there. 2021 came back, same time, March 3rd, all the way to July 5th. And people are like, oh, my God, how are you taking Flower and Garden into towards the heart of summer? Then last year, let's say 2022, same thing, March 2nd, July 4th it went to. So now all of a sudden it seems like they're starting to push the festivals back to the length they were 10 years ago.
Right.
So I don't know. Well, it's curious because we do not have dates yet for Food and Wine, but you might have Epcot for a month plus without a festival. Who knows?
Yeah. Yeah. Unless they have something else planned to sandwich in between there, which I think that's maybe what might be the case. I think the summer months are really, really tough on, you know, being able to walk around Epcot and enjoying the food because it is so hot and oppressive. I don't know if that's my speculation is I think they're going to do that because of the heat.
Smart.
And it could also be because of, you know, the cast members and the staff in those kiosks, you know, kind of. Probably pretty tough for those folks too to be you know out there in the sweltering heat of the summer, but knowing Disney, they probably have something up their sleeve that they might be putting something else out there to kind of fill the gap between those two festivals. But we'll see.
It is very interesting, and that's the only thing I could think of is either they have a little something special planned in between,
mm-hmm.
or B, like you just said as well. Over the last couple of years, since they've extended it so far into summer, and especially let's talk June and July in Florida is a hell of a lot hotter than it is here.
Yeah,
they might have took into consideration that people were like, "Hey, while I love to go eat and drink and explore the world, you know, nothing says I'm hot or disgusting like a trash can and 100 degree heat and you know, So who knows? But it's interesting. I can't wait to see the dates come out for Food and Wine.
Yeah, no, me too. That would be interesting to see. I have a feeling they're going to probably start it around the same time they normally do, probably around September.
All right, folks. That is going to wrap up this edition of the Disney Resorts Podcast. We hope you enjoyed it. For Walt Ramirez, I'm Kenny Hayes. Take care, everybody.